Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Activities for People Living at Home with Dementia. My name is Gail Snyder. I'm the Executive Director for Dementia Friendly Fort Worth, and we are proud to offer this program with funding from the Area Agency on Aging and United Way of Tarrant County. These programs are recorded and are made available for future use through a YouTube channel. And today, our guest is Peggy Spear, with Amon Carter Museum of American Art and the Artful Moments program. And today our theme is suspended art. Peggy, let's get started.
All right. Let me share my screen with you fine folks. There we go. All right, you see it? Nope, you don't see it yet, do you?
Yes, we do see it.
But it's not big.
Not big.
No, it's still in your PowerPoint. Yeah, there you go.
Okay. All right. So like Gail said today, and first of all, my name's Peggy. I think I've met all of you before, but if not, and I'm losing my mind, which I might be, I'm Peggy. Today we are talking about suspended art. And so here at the museum, we have on view currently four artworks that are hanging from our ceiling. So they're suspended in air. And another name for this type of art is kinetic art. Have you guys heard this phrase before?
Yes.
Kinetic art. And do you know another name for art that is hanging from the ceiling or that moves while it's hanging?
Suspended.
Suspended. And there's one, think of like what hangs over a baby's crib. What is the name for that?
Like a mobile?
Mobile, yeah. So here we've got at the museum, four mobiles, or another name for them is kinetic art. And we're going to look at two of them today because one of them is actually coming down soon and the other one we don't own. So that loan will end in a few months, I believe. So our first artwork is entitled Seven and Seven Flower. It is massive and this doesn't do it justice. But can you see, here, we'll start here. Can you tell me what you see in this kind of grainy picture about what you're looking at?
Curves and points.
Points, yeah.
Say that again, Paulette.
Curves and points.
Curves and points.
It makes you not want to take a flying leap to it.
Yeah, it looks kind of like scary, almost kind of like a nightmarish. And
It looks thorny.
Thorny.
It looks like birds of paradise to me.
Birds of paradise. Ooh. Okay.
I think it looks like a giant version of the weed that you blow on.
Oh, that
like a dandelion?
Yes.
Oh yeah, you're right. It does. Okay.
Because the ends of those are different colors. Then the stems that go out?
Yes. Yes, totally. Okay, so we're seeing a lot of, all of you though are referring to very nature-y, natural things. We've got flowers, points and curves.
I see Tim Burton and his artwork in this.
Martha, I see the same thing. Kind of like, what is it, Jack the Pumpkin King, Nightmare Before Christmas?
Yes,
thank you. I didn't know his name.
Yeah. No, very much so. Okay, and so we know the title is Seven and Seven Flowers. So there are seven of those. You can, you know, if you see the bottom one right here, there are seven of these flowers, and there are seven petals on each flower. So that's where the seven and seven flowers, the numbers, what they mean.
Okay.
And the artist, his name is James Searle, and I guarantee you have seen his artwork. He's one of those artists that pick a college campus and there's a sculpture of his there. There are sculptures of his. He's from Dallas. There's sculptures all over Texas from him. In fact, outside of the parking lot here, right by the museum, there's another one of his sculptures. So he's an artist you would recognize and you didn't even realize you've seen him before. That's who created this. But he is from Dallas and he has seven daughters.
Oh my.
So this, could you imagine, seven daughters, that would be a fun household, in my opinion. Seven girls, how fun. And so he made this sculpture as kind of a portrait of his daughters and his family with the seven flowers.
What are the flowers made out of again?
So it's made, I don't think I said, pine limbs that he actually found in his backyard. He now lives in Carbondale, Colorado, but he dragged these big old pieces of pine wood and carved them. And then they're attached to a steel armature. The fingery parts, the pointy parts, that's all wood. But then the parts that it's attached to, like the little part at the end of the wood, well, actually you can see it better here. So you can kind of see the grain of wood at the top.
Yeah.
And how huge they are.
They're massive. So that's what we're going to kind of look at how this bad boy was hung, because it took a team, it took 2 hours, and it took a lot of help. So yeah, you can kind of see how big and it looks heavy the way this is one of our co-workers, Greg. You can see how heavy it looks based on how his arm is. So when we decided that we were going to have this artwork on view here, the artist lives in Colorado. His studio is in Colorado. And he sent down on flatbeds these giant wooden flowers. So the sculpture that we saw in the picture before, that's what it looks like assembled, but we got it in pieces.
Mm.
So we started loading all the flowers in. And these two men here, one of the jobs at the museum is called installation and preparation services. And so these guys are the ones that prepare the artwork to actually hang. And then this woman here, her name is Marcy, she's a registrar, which is another job at the museum, where she looks very closely at all of the artwork, and she's the one that has to be there when they take things out of crates or when they unwrap things to make sure the artwork is in good condition and notes any sort of difference in case something happens during transit or during unpacking, things like that. So she always has to be there when artwork is being moved. So she's there, the guys are moving it in, and then they laid all of the flowers on the floor. So you can see those big old spiky things. There they kind of look like agave plants coming out of the museum floor. And the guys got in a cherry picker, this big blue thing, and had to prepare the ceiling to make sure it could suspend, it could hold all that weight. So that was one of the first things they did before they started hanging the pieces from the ceiling.
Smart.
Right. And we had recently, we just renovated, so we had all this new, in the ceiling, all this new gridding put into our ceiling to support heavy artwork. So this was the first time we were using it. So it was like, oh God, let's hope this works, because this is giving it a go the first time.
So do you know how heavy the sculpture is?
No, I don't. I don't think they weighed it, but it's steel and pine.
Yeah.
A heavy son of a
yeah, gun. That's what I was gonna say.
Know. No, I don't. If they did weigh it, they didn't record it anywhere for me to find it. Okay. But I don't know. I don't know if they know the weight. So they have everything ready to roll. So then they created a pulley system.
I set an alarm for 12.
And they started pulling up. You can see now. Here's the steel armature that all of the flowers were going to attach to. So they had the top flower they put on first just so they could pull that up, but they couldn't pull it up completely until they put the bottom flower so it would balance. Otherwise it would have flipped like that. So it took, right here there are four different guys, and there's more, but in this picture there are four guys who are working to assemble the sculpture. And this man who's really in the petals of the flower is the artist's assistant who came down from Colorado to help him, to help our team. So they started loading all the flowers using the pulley system to lower and adjust and balance as they were doing all this. And then the two people in the foreground right here, this woman, her name is Shirley. She's our curator of this particular artwork. And then Brett, he's the chief curator. They stood back and they gave feedback. We want to hang it lower. We wanted to twist this, you know, a little bit this way, a little bit that way. So they were the kind of the eyes while everybody else was figuring out how to balance it. So you can see they're, again, working the pulley system. And then they finally got it in 2 hours later. And I've got, so this man right here, his name is Tom. And he gave some, he emailed me with some really interesting feedback about what this went down, how this went down. And he said that they would raise, once they would put one flower on, they would pull it all the way to the top to see what it looked like. And then they would lower it again to add another flower on and then pull it back up and then lower it back down. So it was a lot of back and forth and back and forth. And then they would, the flowers, they started from the bottom and then added flowers to the top. So they had the two to balance it and then they worked their way up to the point. And they would use this pulley system that the assistant had come up with. Right here, he's the assistant. He doesn't work on our staff. And then the entire installation took about 2 hours and there were no hiccups along the way, which thank goodness, because they didn't know what they were getting themselves into. They had figured it would take maybe 5 or 6 hours to install this and it took way less because it went so smoothly. So when you're standing directly under it, this is what it looks like. You see all the different points.
Wow.
It's really cool.
Oh, what a fascinating photo.
Isn't it? Yeah, it's, and the lights, they seem so bright, but when you're looking right under it, it's, you don't even notice the lights. You're just kind of in a maze of all these spindly fingers.
Did they install the lights just for this particular piece?
Yes. Yeah, so there's another guy, the guy here, our friend Greg, he also does all the lighting for our artwork. And so once the artwork was installed, then they were able to place the canned lights where they needed to go.
Lighting artwork has got to be a field all unto itself.
It totally mm-hmm. is. And we just, with the new renovation we had here, it used to be that Steve would get in this cherry picker and start placing lights. And then there would be a curator on the floor or someone else to help him kind of angle the lights. Now everything is done on an iPad and is hooked up to a system where he can dim the lumens and things like that. So he's not having to necessarily always go up and replace canisters, but he can control the level of light. It's really very cool because certain artworks, we measure things in foot candles. A lot of you probably already know this, but things are measured in foot candles. And so artworks on paper can only receive so much light. Whereas artworks like organics, like this is wood and steel, as much light as they get, it does almost minimal damage to the artwork at all. So it can have a stronger foot candle versus an artwork on paper or a photograph or an oil painting. So
I was gonna ask you about light damaging the artwork itself.
Yeah, and so a lot of times oil on canvas can stay out for a really long time. Sculptures of stone, of wood, they can stay out almost forever as long as they're protected from elements. But works on paper, like watercolors, photographs, lithographs, things like that, they can typically only stay out for 4 to 6 months, and then they have to rest, and their rest time is usually 7 years.
Oh my.
Wow.
Yeah, so this is nice that this particular sculpture, because do you see all the natural light in the windows right here? It can take a lot of natural light, even though we do have shades that we lower during certain hours of the day, so we're not getting a ton of UV in that might impact some other artwork that's on view. This artwork doesn't need any sort of hood. You know, like if you were to put a cloth over a painting, at night, or if we have lights on and we don't want that light, that artwork doesn't need to be exposed to more lighting than it already is. We put hoods over things. So our conservation team is very aware of how, of what is getting what, how much light, when, and they're constantly checking UV measures throughout the galleries. But this artwork is pretty okay in the light. And then the wood itself can take, you know, if you found it in nature, and Searles would look for tree trunks or tree branches or, you know, whatever, that told a story to him that he felt could tell the story he wanted to tell. So he felt very, you know, the wood he picked very much to him felt that it was telling the story of his different daughters. So that's, you know, he saw how he wanted, the wood would kind of tell him what it needed to look like. So each mark feels very intentional. You can see the marks on each, you can kind of see here, the carving, the look of the carve. You can see the artist's hand there.
So was the wood, is the wood just raw, or is it varnished or something?
I know it's painted, and I don't, I didn't see anything that said it had been sealed or anything, but okay. I can't imagine he doesn't seal it.
Okay.
But, and he also works with a lot of metal too. And those are the sculptures that are typically outdoors, but because this is indoors and intended to be indoors, he did not create it for our museum. But since it is indoors, I think it's not as sealed as it might be if it were going out in a garden or something like that.
So did you say this is on loan or is it permanent?
So it's on loan. It started, I guess, September 2019. It's right now a 2-year loan. So it will be up for essentially another year before the plan is for it to come down. But things like this always change. Like we have a one sculpture, Rainbow, that's overhead. The plan was 2 years and then we ended up acquiring it. So fingers crossed we get this one, but I, you know, who knows what will happen.
Is the whole thing there wood? Where does the metal start and the wood start?
So you can see in this one, down where like the center of the flower would be, you can see the skinny round, that's actually metal. And then you can see in this picture back by where that cart is, that's the metal armature that then is hung up.
Yeah.
You can see this is all metal, but the black with the brown, that's the wood.
Metal's wood, more like a stem or a trunk or something.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly.
Does the metal ever get tested?
Say that again?
Does the metal's metal ever get tested?
We haven't had any issues with ours in terms of holding the weight and things like that. So it seems it's steel. So
sorry.
It's as tough as it gets. But no, and then what's really cool is it does, because it's a mobile, it rotates very slowly.
Oh, really?
The wind.
The air conditioning system moves around?
Yes. Yeah. So you walk in one day and this big old flower might be facing you, or it might be facing the wall, you never know. So it's kind of a very peaceful moment when you're under it, because you see that slight rotation, but it's not enough to make you feel like it's whirling around.
The answer, my friend, is written in the wind.
All right, any other thoughts on our beautiful flowers before we move to something totally different? But a mobile nonetheless.
Well, thank you. That sounds good.
Cool. All right. Moving right along. We're looking at a totally different sculpture called, it's Untitled is the official name, but here at the museum we call it Nacho Calder. We have I'll show you a picture, but we have a Alexander Calder. He's an American sculptor. He's the one who invented the mobile. And if you've been to any museum in the world, you've most likely seen a Calder. And here's a picture of the artist looking at our Calder. And they're so delicate, you can almost never photograph it in a way.
Well, I like his t-shirt.
That's all he ever wears are different black t-shirts with skeletons on them. Huh.
He'd like. It's all made out of lace and it's just a skeleton and then you can see through it, so he could wear that under it.
I guess black and skeleton is slimming.
Yeah, he looks the best he's ever looked. He's the skinniest he's ever been when he's in his skeleton outfit. Paulette, he would love that lace shirt you speak of with the skeleton on it, because he is such a cool and funky guy, and so that would be totally up his alley. So this is what we affectionately call the Nacho Calder, inspired by our Alexander Calder. And he said his name's Justin Favela. He's an artist based out of Las Vegas, Nevada. And he is Mexican, Guatemalan, American. And he's really inspired by his heritage of using arts that are practiced in Mexican arts, like making piñatas, to then create sculpture or murals. We have one of his murals. He created three artworks while he was here, but this is the one that's hanging from the ceiling, and it goes down in, I think, 3 weeks. So we're sad to see our Nacho Calder go, but here is what it looks like. And so let me see here he is working again in another skeleton outfit. But can you kind of see this from this picture, what he included in this sculpture? And we're not looking at Diana. Block out Diana.
What do you mean we're not looking at her?
I mean, I know. It's like, yeah, ignore the man behind the curtain.
So this is made out of cardboard, tissue, and wire?
Yes, cardboard. So you can see what is meant to be a nacho chip.
Okay.
It's made of cardboard. The cheese.
Yeah. With peppers and tomatoes, yes.
Yeah, peppers, tomatoes, jalapenos, lettuce, cilantro, we'll look at a closer detail of it, are all included. So these nachos are calling my name. That is exactly how I like my nachos. I'm not a meat on your nachos person. So this is like, and then he's got the wire, which he wrapped the tissue paper around to create the cascading effect.
What kind of effect?
The cascading, like it looks like it's kind of
cascading. Okay, thank you.
So he created this. Oh, say that again, Gail.
That's what happens when you pull the chip off of the pile.
Yes. She's hanging off of it.
Yeah, we always joke at our house when everything attaches, we always say it's all one nacho, and it's like the whole plate.
That's right.
But so he made this, it's called a site-specific work. So he made this specifically for us, based off of the artwork that we have on view. So he didn't do it alone. He measured everything to match the dimensions specifically to our Calder. And then he started cutting things out of cardboard and tissue paper. And he realized quickly he did not have enough hands to do it all on his own. So he called in the reinforcements, which was staff. So we had, at any given moment, there was anywhere from 2 to 15 staff members helping him with this artwork and another artwork that is on view close by. And here we have two staffers cutting out cardboard. But another girl, you can't see here, she was cutting out tissue paper, like the cilantro and the jalapenos. You can kind of see here.
So you could really call this a macho nacho, right?
It is the machoest nacho. It is massive. And so you can see that cheese here.
I'm trying to behave. I really am. I promise.
Paulette, keep the comments coming. We need it. Well, we got the cheese here, we got the shredded lettuce here, we've got the cilantro here, and then you can see all of the pieces that what Justin was painting with the paint here. You can see all of the pieces laid out, drying. Well, then he started getting to it after everything was cut, and he had the hardest time balancing all of the, you can see up close, here's the detail. Look at that jalapeno, that's my favorite.
Oh.
So he, when he got to, you know, he made all the, he had the help and he made the pieces. What took up most of his time was figuring out, so this is the artwork that inspired him, how perfectly balanced it is. It took him way longer than he thought to figure out how to balance this. And so he said he had a whole new respect for Holger because it was like a perfect math equation for him to figure out how to get it to not completely be lopsided. And I'm sure, Jan, your brain probably loves this kind of stuff, figuring it out.
Yeah, I mean, the balance and the weight of it. And my question is that he was there with you. Did he mind you nicknaming him Nacho Calder?
No, he loved it. He thought it was a charming endearment. And he said, I'm actually going to show you a video of it. This wasn't even part of the plan. He showed up and he saw this Calder and he was so in love with it. He's like, I have to make something inspired by this. So I'm going to show you, if you guys are up for it, I've got a couple of, we did a documentary on this and I've got a couple of just a few minute clips where we can hear the artist himself talk about what he did. Does that sound good?
Oh, great.
All right, let me pull this bad boy up. All right, so here's the first clip. Make sure, yeah.
Two main projects happening right now. The first one is the Nacho.
Sorry.
I have a Calder here at the game of Carter. The moment I saw it, it was a bunch of triangles. And I started laughing and I said, this looks like a bunch of nachos hanging from the ceiling. I need to recreate a Calder as nachos.
Okay, so he got to it there. It was not part of the plan, but he loved it. He's got his skeleton shirt on. Now here is, he ended up spending, I think it was 14, 15 days working between the sculpture. And then he did a whole wall mural, which I think you might be able to see some of it. But here we go.
The video? Is this video, Peggy?
All we can hear is the sound.
All we can hear is the sound.
Oh, you can't see it.
No.
You have to reshare.
Well, let me think.
You have to stop the share on the PowerPoint and then choose
okay. The
share on the video.
Got it. Okay. Yep, you're right. Okay, thank you, Gail. Thank you, guys. I can tell you, it's always something. All right.
There we go.
All right, let's, here, well, now you can see what I'm talking about.
There's two main projects happening right now. The first one is the Nacho Calder. So they have a Calder here at the Amon Carter. The moment I saw it, it was a bunch of triangles. And I started laughing and I said, this looks like a bunch of nachos hanging from the ceiling. I need to recreate a Calder as nachos.
All right, so you've gotten to actually see the visuals of it now. All right, so Dale, if I switch to the next tab, should it work or do I have to exit and restart?
You might be able to switch to the next tab. Try okay. it.
All right, let's see. Can you all see what I'm doing?
Yes.
Okay, good.
We have all of our ingredients for the Calder, which are the nacho chips, the cheese, lettuce, tomato. So now I'm finally getting to the wire.
Okay, we got one more little clip with him working on it.
I'm also trying to finish the Calder, which is become a much bigger project than I thought because of the balance issues, and then the wire I was using wasn't strong enough. So now I finally got something strong enough. So I'm gonna need to just spend some time on that today, which means less time on the mural. I'm worried about the time, but it's gonna get done no matter what.
All right, so just kind of hearing his voice and hearing what he was thinking about, but what he thought was just going to be a fun little project ended up being way more than he bargained for. All right, so
yeah, one thing I've learned, planning ahead just teaches you how to scramble and revise.
Yep. No plan survives the reality.
Ain't it the truth? So the night that he saw that he was working on the wall, we had to be finished for a major event we were having last September. And he finished, the event started at 10. He finished at 6 a.m. that morning.
Wow.
They pulled an all-nighter. And so he said at the end, he was a ghost and that was his actual skeleton. He was so dead from all that work. So it was a sport, but he did it, and it's still on our walls right now, but that will be coming down too in about a month.
So I have a question. Does it have more than one line suspending it from the ceiling?
Mm-hmm. No, the only point of contact is the one point.
Okay.
You can see right here. There isn't anything that's hidden in this picture.
I wasn't sure because over on the other side, where that mm-hmm. light track is, it mm-hmm. almost looks like it's attached there from this angle.
You're right, it does. No, it hangs directly down from that one point. And if you were a tall person who just reached your arm up, you could actually hit the thing if you were tall enough. So, yeah.
That wouldn't be me.
Yeah, well, I'll hoist you on my shoulders and then we can try to see what we got. Oh, go ahead, Martha.
I love this background information. Rather than just walking through and seeing a piece, the story makes it so much more vibrant and real.
Oh, yeah.
This particular artwork and the mural that's hanging on the walls, this guy was just the coolest to work with. And it really made the artwork itself is fun, but it made it more fun working with him because he was like a real card. So. But if you were to make a sculpture of your favorite food, what would that sculpture be?
Favorite food?
Favorite food, because he said nachos are actually one of his favorite foods when we were working with him. So if you were to make a sculpture of your food, what would it be?
Well, there's so many.
I know.
It would look like a cafeteria.
Yeah, probably. Like a buffet.
Yeah, right. Oh, that's funny.
Well, I like spaghetti. I like chicken and noodle stuff.
So what would you use? What kind of materials would you use if you were to make a spaghetti sculpture?
Well, I'd use wire, probably string. Mm-hmm. Probably have to make sure that whatever string I used was solid enough that it could look like a noodle. Yeah. Probably have some meatballs hanging off of it.
What would you make your meatballs out of?
I'd probably make my meatballs out of styrofoam or something.
Oh, that's a good idea. Yeah, yeah.
And the sauce, I'd have to have mixed the spaghetti strands of string with sauce strands, I guess.
Okay, okay.
You could take clay and run it through a pasta machine.
Oh
yeah.
How creative.
And would you have to let it dry then?
Yeah, you have to stretch it out, or bend it the way you want it to stay.
You can
licorice.
Yeah.
Licorice, yeah.
Yeah,
I'm sorry. Go ahead, Gail.
If you wanted to make edible spaghetti that was made out of candy, Peggy, we used licorice in our cookie baking last week. That's why.
It was red, too.
Oh, red, yum. I was going to say, I'm not a black licorice person. But red licorice, that's my favorite.
Hey, Halloween's coming. You want black licorice.
I know.
I love red.
Yeah, reds, I'm with you, Martha. But I'll tell you what, if you try to bring those materials, like actual licorice, and try to make an artwork out of it, conservation will be on you.
Oh, no. Because it's not sustainable?
No, and it draws bugs.
It draws bugs.
Well, just use some flour, put it through a pasta machine, and you got it.
But, you know, if I'm thinking about a size, I was thinking about a size, sculpture size of that. So that's why I didn't think the pasta machine would work very well.
You would need a big old, like the biggest pasta machine you could find.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Really, really getting that arm workout and pumping it through.
Yeah.
You'd have to go down to OB Macaroni and ask to borrow their meeting.
See, pasta machines and polymer clay are good friends.
I believe it. I wonder how many artists know that secret or use that method. I'm sure there's some good ones out there.
I have a few things around the house that I've used for that. So.
Paulette, what would you make? Because you've got some ideas with the clay. What would you make as your food sculpture or mobile?
What would I make as a mobile?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I don't know. Something that would involve my two daughters.
Okay, so you would kind of go the James Searle, the guy who made his kind of a portrait of his family through flowers.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah. Well, are you sure you wouldn't make a Halloween mobile that would have ghosts and witches and
Yeah, but you know, Halloween is my birthday now.
That's
so
right.
So it's even more biographical if you make it spooky.
Yes.
Yeah, there you go.
All right, gang. Well, this was
I gotta say about my birthday, just be careful how you pronounce witch.
Paulette.
But I try to behave. It doesn't work all the time, but I try.
That's all you can do is try.
Hey, Peggy, I've got a question, but I don't know if it's appropriate for this conversation.
Let's hear it.
I'm just trying to understand what the definition of American art is. Is it time? Ooh. Is it based on a time frame? Or is it based on, I don't know.
Well, Ron, you have asked the $1 million question, because this is kind of right now with all of the Black Lives Matter situation happening and, you know, coming to, you know, to people's forefront. American art is American Indians, it's African Americans and Black history, indigenous, you know, and traditionally it's kind of been what people refer to as the canon, which is a list of white men. And so art, you know, art history, art museums are really trying to figure out how we are able to tell all of the different stories told through art in America, starting from before colonialism. And, you know, I used to work at the Denver Art Museum, and the American Indian floor, that was, you know, early pre-Columbian. And so they were, all of the American Indian were all referred to as artists, and not just as American Indian craft, but as they were actual artists, not just that's what their tribe did. So we're trying to more fill in holes in our collection where we're telling a more complete story of American art, starting from before pre-Columbian, through current. So that's people who are of different race, more women in the collection, LGBTQ. So really to give people, so people come into our museum and see themselves on the wall and not just what art history has decided the important artists are. It was a loaded question.
I understand. But I've been there. You have the Western art collection also, right?
That was what our collection was founded on, was the Western art, and we've been growing it more and more. So, for example, this the James Searle's artwork we first looked at with the flowers, and then this macho sculpture, 10 years ago, you would not have seen that in our museum because we kind of stopped around 1950 collecting artists who've made work after that, 1960. So now we're showing more contemporary artists, which is a way to incorporate different practices and points of view. So like this particular artist is gay and of Mexican-American heritage, which hasn't always been what we would showcase here. So it's a cool time right now for us to kind of open the doors and have different things up.
Thank you.
Yeah, sorry, that's a sticky topic right now in the field, so.
I can imagine.
Yeah. Any other questions or comments about the artwork today?
Oh, I have been working at the Art Museum in Houston, that's for sure. I loved it.
Cool. Yeah.
I'm so grateful.
Good, Martha. We're glad you're here.
More art, please.
Yes.
And John, art.
Love it.
Every John Wednesday. Enjoyed the show today.
Yay! Well, we're glad John was here.
Oh, yeah, it was wonderful. Round of applause.
Well, Paulette, you'll be hearing some more. You'll be hearing some of the same stuff and new stuff tomorrow. And just a reminder, the Eamon Carter is hosting a longer version of this, and we're doing art making at the end. So you will be making your own mobile. But if I don't see you all tomorrow through the Eamon Carter, then I will see you next week with Gail. And
looking forward to it.
Yeah.
Next week for our art, our theme is color.
Oh, yay!
Cool.
Oh, I love color.
We'll get some fun sculpture and abstract, so get all ready for it, gang.
Okay.
Thank you.
Look forward to it.
Thank you so much, Peggy. That was a lot of fun.
Hey, guys. Well,
appreciate you, Peggy.
Oh, thank y'all. This was a fun conversation.
Great job. You do a great job.
Oh, thank you. You guys, stop it.
All right, Woodstock is even grooving.
Good. Okay, thanks, Peggy.
Yeah. Oh, great program. Great program. Yeah. Great
program. All right. So tomorrow we will be playing Jeopardy. Okay. At the end of our session yesterday, we kind of went around the room and everybody decided they'd like to play Jeopardy tomorrow. So I will see you all tomorrow morning at 10:15 for an exciting game of Jeopardy.
You say 10:15?
10:30. Did I say 10:15? Okay.
Yeah, you were thinking yourself of getting ready for it.
Yeah, that's right.
It's 10:30 for us.
And we can visit at 10:15.
That's right.
Yes, that's a good part too.
All right.
Janine, Paul, and Don, good to see you.
Gail, bye. Good to see you too.
Y'all have a great rest of your day, and I'll see you all tomorrow.
Okay.
Bye. Fantastic start. So thank you for the good start. Thank you.
You're very welcome. Thank you.